not reached. By looking at the gospel through the eyes of an astronomer, we can understand why the gospels follow the same story outline. The tale of Jesus, or of the sun, takes place within one zodiac year, which is divided into 12, the same number as Jesus' apostles. By breaking down the gospels according to each of the 12 zodiac constellations, we can track Jesus, which has a 12-year orbit along the sun's ecliptic through references to each motif that the constellations correspond to. Astronomical timetables are enumerated into 12 ages, which not only speak to the 12 months of the solar year, but on a great cycle spanning almost 26,000 years. The age of Pisces began around 6 BC, which is why the latter parts of the Gospels refer often to 6. That said, constellations play a pivotal role in astrotheology, and today I'd like to focus on the role of the unicorn. Monoceros is Latin for unicorn, and is the name of the constellation of the unicorn, only visible in the winter months in the northern sky. Then it disappears from view, reappearing again the following winter, until it appears to die, and then is reborn again the following winter, December 25th, which also coincides with the winter solstice.
I can see.
So, in an astrological context, the unicorn has been associated and represents Christ. During the medieval period, the church demonized astrology. In other words, it was not allowed for the general public. While Christian writings interpret the unicorn and its death to Jesus, certain occult circles regard an esoteric significance to it, which predates Christianity altogether. When Christian scholars interpret some aspects of the unicorn as an allegory for Christ's relationship with the Virgin Mary, the pagan myths involving the unicorn's form refer to sacred acts that require a virgin, or at least elements of chastity, the unicorn symbolic of purity, and that divine energy that many call God or goddess. The hunts of the unicorn are a set of 7 unicorn tapestries that date back to the Middle Ages, which were purchased by John D. Rockefeller Jr. in 1922 for about $1 million, which translates to $25 million in today's money.
As a result of father's and mother's interest in medieval art and architecture, when they heard from a dealer in France whom they'd known and through whom they bought a certain number of things, of the availability of a remarkable set of Gothic tapestries called the Unicorn Tapestries. I think this was back in the 20s. They were delighted to be able to buy them. This was certainly one of the most wonderful acquisitions that my parents were ever able to acquire. While my parents rarely talked about the symbolism of the tapestries, they did tell me the story of the hunt of the unicorn. The unicorn, they explained, is the symbol of Christ. And as a result of father's and mother's interest in medieval art and architecture, when they heard from a dealer in France whom they'd known and
fascinating.
Whom they bought a certain number of things, of the availability of a remarkable set of Gothic tapestries called the Unicorn Tapestry. I think this was back in the 20s. They were delighted to be able to buy them. This was certainly one of the most wonderful.
Hello. So we had some sound issues there. I'd love to listen to this again.
And the tapestries depict scenes which can be interpreted in an astrological context, such as this one, which shows 12 hunters, which represent the 12 houses of the zodiac. The scenes range from the start of the hunt to the unicorn being attacked, captured, and made docile by a virgin. esoteric or sacred sex or spiritual context, and too much for me to cover in detail in such a short video. That said, there's another aspect of the unicorn mythology that I wanted to touch on, which was denied by the tradition of the medieval Roman Church.
Hello, hello.
Jesus may have been a father, and not just the celibate
God,
but the horn of the unicorn, the symbol for his virility.
Welcome to the Boh Sho part 2 for tonight. We had a bit of a power failure. We're sort of running on the bare minimum of power at the moment. So we're just making things, we're just getting by. We've got power for the lighting and our water pump. This is fascinating, this show. Talking about unicorns and the hunt for the unicorn. Wish I could set this up with the sound for it to work better. Maybe I can use this mic here.
In fact, some Gnostic sect, crucified, or that
that's
he had survived the crucifixion, and had come to southern France to escape further persecution.
I'm gonna watch this again. I hope you don't mind.
In the place of the sun, related to any other winter solstice, also shared by many other of righteousness.
All right, this is great.
So let's just take a few moments then together and try to remember, why is Christmas Day on December the 25th?
Ring, ring, ring a ding.
That's the birth of our Lord Jesus Christ. It's a midwinter solstice. It's a pagan festival that's been appropriated by Christianity.
There is a great deal of truth in that. It was indeed, there's a Teutonic, Celtic, and pagan view that if you survived the winter solstice on the 21st of December, you have a feast to celebrate. But also, there was the Roman god.
Was it Saturnalia?
There was the Saturnalia, was also at that time of year, but there was Mithras. He was a savior, Mithras, sent to earth to live as a mortal, through whom it was possible for sinners to be reborn into immortal life. He died for our sins, but came back to life the following Sunday. He was born of a virgin on December the 25th in a manger, or perhaps a cave, attended by shepherds, and became known as the light of the world. He had 12 disciples with whom he shared a last meal before dying. His devotees symbolically consumed the flesh and blood of him. Because Mithras was a sun god, he was worshipped on Sundays, and Mithraists gave each other gifts on December the 25th. The leader of the religion was called a Papa, and their HQ was on Vatican Hill in Rome. Well, a lot of Christian scholars have since been very angry at some of this research, which came out in 1903 about Mithraists, and they claim it's nonsense.
Oh, good
boy. There's a great deal in Christianity.
Our cat just caught
me. However wonderful people think the story is, it's frankly not original.
By looking at the Gospels through the eyes of an astronomer, we can understand why the Gospels...
I better go and check. I'll leave this with you.
The tale of Jesus, or of the sun, takes place within one zodiac year, which is divided into 12, the same number as Jesus' apostles. By breaking down the Gospels according to each of the 12 zodiac constellations, we can track Jesus, Jupiter, which has a 12-year orbit along the sun's ecliptic through the references to each motif that the constellations correspond to. Astronomical timetables are enumerated into 12 ages, which not only speaks to the 12 months of the solar year, but on a great cycle spanning almost 26,000 years. The age of Pisces began around 6 BC, which is why the latter parts of the Gospels refer often to fish. That said, constellations play a pivotal role in astrotheology, and today I'd like to focus on the role of the unicorn. Monoceros is Latin for unicorn, and is a name of the constellation of the unicorn, only visible in the winter months in the northern sky. Then it disappears from view, reappearing again the following winter, and so appears to die, but then is reborn again the following winter, December 25th, which also coincides with the winter solstice, where the sun is reborn. So, in an astrological context, the unicorn has been associated and represents Christ. During the medieval period, the church demonized astrology. In other words, it was not allowed for the general public. While Christian writings interpret
so much history to unravel.
Jesus,
I find it so fascinating. All right, that's enough of the Robert Ziffer. He's got a channel on YouTube if anyone wants to look into him. Hello? Okay. Hello? Hopefully you can hear me. Okay now? Check, check, check. Okay, How to Change the World, Part 6. Welcome. We're running a bit late now. This is the late night edition. But my challenge to myself was to do this every night. So I'm here, and maybe try and just do an hour. Yeah, so we'll see how we go. But yeah, How to Change the World. I have come to the conclusion that each night we're going to talk about the same thing, which is how to change the world. And my desire is to talk about changing the world through community living and rebuilding these wonderful communities or tribes that cater for a total family. So basically creating families, but on a big scale. So yeah, this is my new desire in the world, actually, and just happened to be unfolding a community in Carriedale. So hey, how's it going? yeah, so I've just started, basically. I'm every night I talk about the same thing, how to build a tribe and why we want to build a tribe.
Do people call in?
No, not yet. That would be cool. But you can actually you don't have to call in, you can get online now and comment.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, which is pretty cool. Cuz we're streaming live, which I should check to see if it's actually working. We're on Jenny at the moment. You just can plug in.
Yeah, but I haven't got a plug.
Oh, yeah. What are you after?
Galaxy.
There's probably one on the thing there. On the. Oh, there's one here, actually. Is it a USB-C? The round oval one?
Yeah. It's on iOS.
Oh, there should be one on that rack. So how do we change the world? So this is the beautiful thing about doing it every night. It's like, how do you explain it? Because you can start from all different angles. Because it's a rather large topic. So where do I want to start tonight? I've been enjoying delving into history. Because what I believe is that there's been civilizations or cultures that like really nailed a system that allowed harmony in the population. And there is examples of that throughout history that we can find. And so we can utilize this, the experiences, the wisdom and all the learnings from the past on building ideal systems to create harmony, love, joy, bliss, expansion of truth, consciousness raising. Like all these things will come about when you have an ideal system where humans live. We have to find the most natural state of flow, and then the universe, the divine, will manage it. And this is, I guess, one of the core understandings of building a system that allows for flow. And it needs to be flow, it needs to be free. So you've got to have this pretty much zero rule system where you put trust in the people. And with that trust comes building a family. So it's a very different way to look at how we build something, aiming to keep it into its natural flow state as possible. And every time we put a rule in place or a barrier, a wall, then it prevents that flow state. And I think even large organisms need to have that flow to function correctly. So we need to look at the past and how we find these civilizations or cultures that did find the secret recipe for. I'm just made one actually. Thank you. Yeah, we got to find those civilizations, and so I've been looking and I found these people that look like they conquered the world, and started to look into some of the information that's been left through history. And my theory or my gut feel or my knowing is that they separated when the perfect system is a tribal type system, like a circular system where everyone's included. And they split the tribes into 12 clans. So there was 12 clans. We had the 12 clans, and each clan had an individual type of characteristic or a energy. So you would have the farming clan, you'd have the warrior clan, you'd have the ruling priest clan, you'd have the I've actually even got to the point where if you look at the 12 zodiacs, because obviously 12, so you've got 12 types of people, but you could also even jump to the conclusion that they were telling us what we had in each clan. So you've got, you know, if I go through them all, there's the fisherman, the water bearer, what are there? There's a few others. You know, the scales, the judges, you know, you had to have the administration, the Libras, yeah, so there was 12 tribes, 12 zodiacs. I think those 12 zodiacs are telling us something. Because I know this all seems so like far out there, but it, to me, if there's a bit of knowledge that the ancients want to give us, it's how to build a system that allows us to function and in a state where we can raise consciousness the most, and we find that joy and bliss the quickest. So you build it. So they would have developed a system, because they had thousands and thousands of years of trial and error. You know, the best tribe would win over the weakest tribe. So if you had developed the best system for its people, then they're going to be the ones that survive the longest. So it's called like natural selection. And I believe that these Aryan people discovered this perfect system. I mean, you could say, well, there's nothing perfect, but it allowed total creation. Like, because when you have the 12 clans, you know, if there's the metal workers or the stonemasons, right? All the best stonemasons are in that clan. And then you've got people coming up, and it's just a wealth of wisdom and skills to share. And the more masters you've got, the more experts you've got, the more, and it just, creativity propels itself. Like Michelangelo kind of people, yeah, that's it. You get to that type of levels of, yeah. That's it. So, and each clan, like you have the musician, entertainers clan, and they become, you just get fucking amazing musicians playing. And then what would happen was the 12 clans would, I don't know how far apart they were, but they'd all come together regularly, and they'd probably have a central space where they would all come together and celebrate big parties. Lots of, oh yeah, yeah, jeez, thank you. Yeah, so that, like, because what you have to have in a community is you've got to have harmony. And if you've split them off into 12 clans, still there. So that you've got to have harmony between the clans. You've got to have love, because as soon as one drops out, the whole thing falls apart. You've all got to be, and this is the thing, is if you're in a tribe and you're all for survival of the tribe, right? This is a different time in the past where it was, everyone had to work together to survive. If anyone dropped out of the system, then the whole place could fall apart, right? One person let the whole team down.
And that was the education system, was the system.
Right, yep. Yep, yeah, that exactly.
Died in it.
Exactly. And you probably got the genetics to do that, you know? If you're a fucking good stonemason, it probably does pass down.
Yeah.
I'm sure it does.
Like a muscle memory.
Yeah. You see that with musicians, like, they all breed musicians, generally. Mm. But this is the thing with this clan system. If you're in the musician's clan and you're born into it, but you want to be a warrior, you just, because it's a family, you can just go over there and move in, and you're accepted in.
Yeah.
And so there's this free travel, free movement, and that's where I think then you get the most growth for people,
because
they can experience what they want to experience. They can just go to clan to clan. Then this is the idea of the gypsy. The gypsies were always, you know, they're always moving. And then you have like people like storytellers moving between the clans.
Yeah.
Always moving and sharing information and stories and telling heroic stories of fucking knights. Yeah. Mm. So that, like, I've often thought now, what we do, though, we create 12 villages, and whether they're quite close together or they're, you know, 100 k's apart, but now you can start utilizing, the way I think is money is no object, right? We've got unlimited funds, so you build these villages with 12 of them, possibly, you know, maybe only 5 k's apart. And then but you have transport between them, like super amazing transport, like a monorail, you know, and then so people can just move between them.
Have you seen Lighthouse?
I have, yeah, a while back.
Did you see the old?
Do you want to go on the mic? Come, just come. You don't even have to. You can put them on if you want. You don't have to. It sounds better. You feel like you're in the system.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's quite good. You get nothing else, distraction. But Zeitgeist.
Did you see the...
Hang on, I think your mic is on.
Testing.
Can you hear yourself? Can you hear me? I can't. Can you speak in the mic for a sec?
Testing 1, 2, 3.
Can't hear.
Testing 1, 2, 3.
I think you're gonna have to bring it closer.
Okay, how's that? I'll go this side.
No.
This side's good. I don't want to talk too loud.
It's funny. Can you hear your voice?
Yeah.
Oh, you can.
Very clearly.
Huh? Hello, hello.
Hello.
I can't hear you though. Hello. That's the. I'm not getting a. Yeah, I think you're going to have to go closer.
That's different.
There you go. See when you can hear yourself?
Dude, I don't want to go that close.
Hello, hello. I know. I've got these speakers. I don't know. Whatever a cough mic is.
Like you cough into the mic. Yeah, so Zeitgeist.
Mm.
You've seen that. Did you see the old dude on it? And he created that circular, the same thing that you were...
The circular villages. Horoscope.
The villages.
Yeah. Oh, did he? On Zeitgeist.
Exactly what you were talking about.
Really?
Yeah.
Sweet.
Yeah. In the '70s, he warned the world about the oil crisis. He basically everything he said came true.
Yeah. Nice.
And he said we should forget about money.
Mm.
We should create societies in a tribal fashion.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. I'd like to know this guy.
But all the tribal, they would be systematic. They would be the same. They would just be units, you know.
What do you mean, units?
Like the same thing. You'd have the 12. In the center, it would start with a main dome, like with the entertainment and the main education offices. Maybe I don't know.
Yep.
And then around that would be, I guess, the second priority of their system, and around that would be another, and then around it another one, and the transport would be interacting through it all.
Yep,
and
totally.
There would be no level of society, just the one level of society. Maybe with all the living quarters on the outskirts of that center,
around the central hub.
You know,
and this is the cool thing. This is what I'm going to make happen is this. We do a demonstration project of this. We build 12 villages and we have one tribe, and maybe each village has 1,000 people in it, right? And you create basically a fully sustainable tribe. Like each 12 villages are all producing and creating things that make it sustainable for the tribe. So they're all producing, boop, 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 boop. They're all sharing.
Like the Tasmanian Aborigine have got things that the Northwestern Australian Aborigine made.
Right.
You know.
Yep.
So they traded all that way.
Mm. Yeah, yeah. We had Ben, is an Aboriginal from Alice Springs.
Yeah.
And he was saying that the ochre that they had in where their sacred space, where they got the ochre, it was traded all over Australia.
That's right.
That's what the medicine men used, that ochre.
Yeah, it was one of the popular blends,
Yeah.
I think that you had 6 tenths, didn't you?
Mm-hmm.
It'd be good if you had the 12.
Wouldn't it?
You know.
Yeah, totally. This is what I want to do. Like, let's do it here. Because this is the start. I see this, as I say, this is the show home. It's the show community. Yep. So we can then get the money to do it on a big scale. And then, so the idea is that we show how it's done. We create this tribal system. And it's all based on holistic healing and, like you have a tribe, one clan's plant medicines. And
I like the idea of the public coming in. You know, and I don't like saying public. Of like-minded entities.
Yes, yeah, that's a good way to put it. Like-minded, yeah. But the really interesting thing is, it seems like only like-minded people want to come here anyway. Mm. A lot of people just aren't interested. It doesn't resonate with them.
Maybe they haven't heard yet.
Yeah, I mean... But there's people have impressions and then they don't step past that.
They've got their own impressions before they even... The judgments come before...
Already,
They're sentenced before the case.
Exactly, yeah. And you see that. And that's okay, you know. But the people who haven't made those judgments or can step past them, they're the ones that are coming here.
Yeah.
Yeah, and so that's... It sort of works out perfectly. It's sort of like just going with the flow.
What is it? I don't care how.
Very much.
How's your message going?
Yeah. Yep. And this is the thing, once the message gets out, and I feel like we set up a system, like the we talked about, like we had some people last night upset with the music, and
okay.
It's like, because they're not in their right areas.
That's right, yeah.
You know, you've got to have the mothers and the people who just want a quiet night in one area.
Yeah. All 4,500 movies. Every I got the first movie ever made by Edison. It's like a 30-second thing. You know,
sweet.
In a real train station, you know, yeah. Just pretending that they're robbing it. You know.
Oh, man, there's so much. You could play stuff all day long in a way.
I've got 100 TV shows, start to finish.
Yep.
Weeds.
Yep.
I never watched that. Sopranos.
Yeah.
Weeds is good show.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
Good show.
Yeah.
Oh, a lot of shows.
Mm.
A lot of shows, man.
Mm.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's some... I'm amazed at writers and how they can weave a story.
Yeah.
Like, there's some really good writers out there making good TV shows. You know? And they're all educating people in life. Mm.
I agree.
Mm. Mm. Yeah. Subtle messages, helping people, you know? Rise in consciousness, I reckon. But then there's also the other shows that sort of, I can't think of any shows, but like, I think some shows aren't necessarily positive. They sort of make people fear.
I think like a show like Roseanne.
Yeah.
Remember Roseanne?
Yeah, yeah.
I think that was a great show.
Mm.
But they just didn't let her go far, as far as she wanted to go.
Right, she wanted to really be free. Yeah, she's a wild woman.
But the thing is, they do now.
Mm.
They do let them go that far.
Mm. Oh, this is the beauty of Netflix. I think it's opened up a little bit.
It just goes to show, but how someone's all got to pay the price for us all to go ahead with that.
Yep.
You know, doesn't matter what genre or work or.
Yep. Someone's got to pay a price.
Someone's always got to pay a price. You know, like, look at Elvis Presley, you know.
Mm.
Why do they call him King of Rock and Roll? Or because he was the first one to feed the drug addict.
Yep.
But everybody was okay with it because he joined the army.
Yep.
You know.
Yep. Yep. He broke all the rules. He really did, didn't he?
He was a king, man.
Yeah, yeah. Yep.
I love Elvis Presley.
Yeah, yeah.
I love
him. And he was way ahead of his time, but he had to come along and do it.
Yeah.
Right, he had to
it was just all natural to him.
Yeah, yeah. It was, but he had to come along at that time to start the movement.
Of course.
Yeah.
As
you say, there's always going to be those people that are going to get torn down, but they're the ones shining the light.
Yeah, absolutely.
Mm.
I like the story about how he went to the White House and got the FBI badge.
Oh, yeah?
And he met Nixon.
Yeah, right. I don't know the story.
He basically ran away from home. They made a movie about it.
Mm.
He basically walked out of the mansion without anybody seeing him.
Mm.
He went to the airport and he pretended that he was an undercover agent because he collected law enforcement medals over the country.
Mm.
You know, police departments, detectives, narcotics. Anyway, so, and he always carried a Magnum 44 on him.
Really?
He carried several guns on him.
Yeah, right.
His ankle and that, you know. And he went to the airport and he went up to the, and he had no money because he never used to carry money. And he went up to the counter and he said to the woman, you know, my name's, you know, such, he changed his name, you know. And he said, look, I've got to let you in, but you're not allowed to tell anybody. I'm a secret agent, you know, and I've got to get to the White House and talk to the president. So she went and got the security. She actually gave him a ticket, but have you got any weapons you want to declare? And he goes, oh, of course, you know, I always carry this, you know. She goes, oh, I have to get the security, you know. So security come and got him. And he called up an old friend of his that used to get him out of trouble and that, in his younger days and that. And he came along and he said to the security guard, have you got a daughter?
Mm.
You know, and that fixed everything, you know.
Because
he got a picture of
of Elvis. So he just went.
The daughter, and so they let him on the plane.
Wow. Yeah.
So no worries, he gets to Washington, he goes up to the gatepost, and he's like, I want to see the president. He goes, like, you've got to make an appointment, you know.
Yeah.
He's like, I don't think you understand. And so his mates are jumping in again. And his mates are like, you know, I think you might want to tell the president on this one who's come to the gate, you know.
Yeah.
So he's rang, and it was right when Nixon was going through, just before he was going through the Watergate thing.
Right.
So he needed some popularity.
Yep.
And his aides,
yep.
You know, they said, oh, this is a good thing, so, you know, let's do this, you know. So he finally, and he didn't want to, Nixon didn't want to, but he finally got him in there. And it was just the funniest thing, mate. He was doing these karate moves in front of the, first of all, he brought him a present of an old gun. I think it was Al Capone's gun, maybe, I'm not sure, but it was that style. And, or General Patton, I'm not sure. But, it was a beautiful gun in a case with the bullets, and they wouldn't let that through. But while he was in talking to him, he said to him, oh, I bought you a present, but they wouldn't let me give it to you, you know. And they're like, oh, where is that present? Where is that present, you know? And so they brought that into him, you know, which is, you know, you're not supposed to. And he's doing that, he's mucking around with karate, kicks and that with Nixon, and that, you know, they get the photos.
Yeah.
And, yeah, it was funny. It was funny. Because he was only supposed to be a five-minute meeting. And, and it went on for about an hour and a half or so.
What an amazing man, though, to just go and
he
do
got
that.
His FBI. He wanted the CIA medal, but he got an FBI one instead.
Wow.
That's a stoner.
Yeah, totally. I'd love to know more about him. I think he was a true, buddy champion out there.
Yeah, I read the book that Priscilla wrote. She wrote a book to set the record straight on everything, and she was absolutely 100% honest with everything. It was fantastic.
Yeah, amazing. Because have you seen Priscilla, and then there's the younger one, and now the younger one's got a child as well.
Lisa Marie,
and then she's got a child.
Yeah,
they all look the same. It's insane.
Yeah, I know. Oh,
cheers, Spider.
Yeah.
Yeah, they all look the same.
That's cool. Don't they? Isn't that uncanny?
And Priscilla hasn't really aged, you know. She still looks pretty amazing.
She's got a bit of plastic surgery.
Oh, I'm sure there's a little bit of work there.
Sorry.
Attacked by the cat.
Yeah, I didn't know what I thought it was a spider.
Cat just took out a rat.
Did it?
Yeah.
Oh, you beaut.
Yeah. Good boy.
I was working at the Waterwheel Flour Mill back in 85 when they had the big mice plague.
Oh, right.
In central Victoria.
Yeah, right.
I was working. And you'd pick a sack up and there'd be 40 mice minimum under there. Then, you'd whack a few or whatever. And then you put the sack down and pick it up half an hour later and there'd be another 40.
Yeah, wow.
I used to wake up with them on my chest.
Little
family of mice having dinner. I opened my eyes up and I'd try to.
Shit.
And they wouldn't even move.
So what happened to them? They just ate everything?
They ate from New South Wales into Victoria through to South Australia and then they turned back and came back through.
Wow. So they're just on a marauding pack. Well,
I think that plague might have been the second biggest in the history. So it was pretty big.
Whoa.
They'd be on the road looked like an ocean. At night time when you was driving home.
Wow.
The car would slide a little bit sometimes,
on
a straight road.
Yeah, right. Wow.
Yeah. They'd always be on your windscreen and that.
Yeah.
You know, die behind the heater and the fridge and in the walls.
Shit. And then they just disappeared?
Yeah, just I guess they did, yeah.
Yeah.
It just stopped.
Yeah. It's interesting, isn't it?
Yeah.
Fuck. You feel like the plague out of the Bible, you know.
Do you know what? When I lived in Geraldton about 30 years ago, there was a locust plague.
Oh, right.
And you take one, it just looked like normal ground.
Mm.
And you take one step, and a million locusts would fly up in your face, you know, each step. You know, it was just insane.
Yeah. And did you know that they turn into it, like the grasshoppers, and then they turn into locusts?
Something like that. I didn't actually know that.
Yeah, it's fascinating, but they all turn at the same time.
Wow.
And then they just all go fucking...
Whoa.
Yeah.
Subconscious.
Yeah,
explosion.
They're all connected somehow, you know, and it's like, all right, it's time, baby, let's go. And then they change their, like, I think their bodies.
The 100th locust effect.
Yeah, yeah, fully connected. Yeah. I'd like to know more, actually. This is the beauty of locusts. If you can spell. How would you spell locust?
L-O-C.
Locust. Q?
Sure.
That's a tough one, isn't it?
L-O-C.
Locust.
Locust.
L-O-C.
U-S-T.
U-S-T. Oh, yes. There we go. Locust swarm. Yeah, it's interesting. I seriously believe it's like Mother Nature just going, fucking settle down, boys.
It has to be something to balance.
Just showing the power of like nature.
Yeah.
You can fire up things at any moment. You know?
Absolutely.
If she's not happy.
She'll always win.
Yeah, that's it.
Always.
Yeah. Here we go. I'd love to have the podcast where you can have a screen up and show these guys what we're watching.
Yeah. So you can do that, but yeah.
The young locusts are known as hoppers, for at this stage they're flightless.
That's good.
They find new feeding grounds by following the smell of sprouting grass. Normally, it takes 4 weeks for hoppers to become adults. But when the conditions are right, as now, their development switches to the fast track. As the vegetation in one place begins to run out, the winged adults release pheromones, scent messages, which tell others in the group that they must move on. And when groups merge, they form a swarm.
It's why we get sexually attracted to each other. But it's what's inside the pheromone, the information. And what it is the female's pheromone picks up that what the male's antibodies have got in it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, totally.
The female, the human female smells that.
Yeah, have you seen they've done these T-shirt tests where they have a guy on.
I mean, that's incredible.
Yeah, have you seen on YouTube the videos of guy, like they have a guy rub his on a particular pheromones, rub the T-shirt.
No, I don't think I have.
And then they give it to women a couple of different pheromone types.
Yeah. And some of them
see which ones they
say yummy,
they like.
And some of them say yuck.
Yeah, they just feel that if they like it, yeah, exactly.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow.
It's real.
That's because
it's a real
of the antibodies.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, it's unconsciously.
So if she really wants the man, that's because she wants to have his baby.
Yeah, exactly. That's it.
You know,
it's like good matchup.
Yeah, and if he's the same with her, it's the same reason. They know he knows that she's
100%.
The baby's going to have.
And did you know that the pill?
Yes.
It masks those pheromones.
I truly would believe that.
Yeah, and what happens is women will find their mate while they're on the pill. Like the pheromones are different, and time after time women
like
say,
a mismatch.
Yep, and as soon as they come off the pill, they're not attracted to that guy anymore.
That's why they... That could be one of the reasons for prenatal.
prenatal.
The prenatal depression.
Sure. Yeah.
You know, because they've got to go off the pill, don't they? You know?
Yeah. Fuck yeah. I mean, you realise you're not with the right guy.
But
you've been masking it with.
If they go off the when they're pregnant, you know what I mean, and then they realise they're with the wrong guy.
Oh, totally. Yeah.
That's why they keep. Yeah. The prenatal depression.
Because you're only like they come off the pill maybe a couple of months before.
That's like fucking. Yeah. Wow.
Yeah, it's a proven thing.
Yeah, it's fascinating. It's these things that make me feel guilty of being a man. Sometimes. No, I know that. I'm not really feeling guilty, but I'm, you know what I mean? It makes you feel like, you know, ashamed to be a man sometimes.
No, I never feel that.
No. When I go back in history, man, whew, those women have done a good job.
Oh, yeah. But that's, but that's the thing. We can hold ourselves high, but, like, I see we see the amazingness of what women have held this whole, beautiful. The world together.
Yeah.
You know, they've held it together through all the bullshit that possibly men have created, right? they've been the bedrock still holding the families together and raising the children.
Absolutely.
Yeah. While the men have been off fighting wars and fucking, the real fucking heroes.
The men are off getting the wage in the wars.
Yeah, and having fun.
Regretting.
Having fun. Like, tell me it wouldn't be fun going off on
getting
a
your head
cross.
Off.
Well, there's a risk. It was always a risk. But, you know, that's, you know, we talked about the Vikings earlier. Like, you know, a lot of the Vikings were, they became guards for the kings and queens of Europe.
That's exactly right.
Yeah.
That's right.
Yeah, they
were the tall and.
Yeah, and.
That's right.
Yeah, which is fascinating, you know.
They let England have England. They just wanted to have a part of it.
Yes. Yeah, that's right.
Led Zeppelin sings that song.
Yeah. They just ruled it.
Yeah.
Right? They ruled it. And, and they put in place a lot of their like systems that still hold true now, right? The Normans put in.
Yep, they did.
You know, as soon as they went there, they did a full account. That there's a book that tells everything about the country.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
Yeah, the Doomsday Book they call it. Wonder why they call it that. It's fucking.
Yeah.
It's
Doomsday Book.
Yeah.
I'll be back in a second.
Yeah, man. Are you boiling a cuppa?
Yeah.
It's a cuppa.
Well, why don't you make a cuppa and I'll go across and quickly roll another.
I've got one in here.
Oh, you still got that?
Yeah. Yeah, we can have that if you want.
Cuppa first.
Okay, All right. I'm going to put the a video on here. I'm going to put this one back on because this is fucking. You should listen to this video. This will blow your mind. So we're going to listen to it.
Predates Christianity altogether. Where Christian scholars interpret some aspects of the unicorn as an allegory for Christ's relationship with the Virgin Mary, the pagan myths involving the unicorn's horn refer to sacred acts that require a virgin or at least elements of chastity, the unicorn symbolic of purity, and that divine energy that many call God or goddess. The hunt of the unicorn are a set of seven unicorn tapestries that date back to the Middle Ages, which were purchased by John D. Rockefeller Jr. in 1922 for about $1 million, which translates to $25 million in today's money.
As a result of father's and mother's interest in medieval art and architecture, when they heard from a dealer in France whom they'd known and through whom they'd bought a certain number of things, of the availability of a remarkable set of Gothic tapestries called the Unicorn Tapestries. I think this was back in the 20s. They were delighted to be able to buy them. This was certainly one of the most wonderful acquisitions that my parents were ever able to acquire. While my parents rarely talked about the symbolism in the tapestries, they did tell me the story of the hunt of the unicorn. The unicorn, they explained, is the symbol of Christ, and the resurrection is represented in the last tapestries, where the unicorn has revived after having been killed by hunters.
Of course, the number 7 holds occult significance in itself, and the tapestries depict scenes which can be interpreted in an astrological context, such as this one, which shows 12 hunters, which represent the 12 houses of the zodiac. The scenes range from the start of the hunt to the unicorn being attacked, captured and made docile by a virgin, then killed, then appearing in the castle in captivity, but alive or resurrected. The tapestries are very rich in symbolism, both astrologically and in an esoteric or sacred sex and or spiritual context, and too much for me to cover in detail in such a short video. That said, there's another aspect of the unicorn mythology that I wanted to touch on, which was denied by the tradition of the medieval Roman Church, that Jesus may have been a father and not just the celibate son of God, but the horn of the unicorn, the symbol for his virility, could purify the polluted waters, so to speak. As we see here, the unicorn and the maiden and the purification of the stream. The church fathers who recognize the unicorn as a symbol for Jesus Christ explain his head in the lap of the maiden by explaining that Jesus is trying to return to the womb of his mother. Clearly this is a stretch and an attempt by the church patriarchs to take away any sexual connotation of his horn. Not only that, but any insinuation that Jesus fathered any children, that any offspring or bloodlines existed. In fact, some Gnostic sects, such as the Cathars, believe Jesus was never crucified or that he had survived the crucifixion and had come to southern France to escape further persecution. Southern France, which is also near Basque country, incidentally, has among the highest concentration of Rh negative blood type and also suffered the greatest death toll during the Inquisition, with a near total extermination of the Cathars at the hands of the church. In the hunt tapestries, popular in the Middle Ages, the unicorn is hunted and viciously attacked by dogs. Since the pure white unicorn is a symbol for Christ, it has been suggested that in the hunt for the unicorn tapestries, the unicorn represented the Cathar faith, hounded and eventually destroyed by the Vatican in the 13th century. The word Cathar comes from the Greek katharoi, meaning pure. While most modern historians and religious scholars will interpret purity to imply a purity of faith, in certain occult and esoteric organizations, this is understood to mean a genetic or racial purity, where an allegedly chosen people were targeted during the Inquisition, which especially vilified women, as they were the ones regarded as the carriers of the bloodline and labeled as witches, who were then eliminated, usually by torture or being burned alive. Prior to World War II, the German nationalist organization known as the Annenerbe organized a team of SS researchers to collect records of historical witchcraft trials that had taken place in the lands of the expanding Reich. The ideological pretext for this undertaking was the collection of evidence demonstrating an anti-German or anti-Aryan crusade by the church. Wow, these geese are lucky Thanksgiving is about turkey, or their goose would be cooked. Just kidding, I couldn't resist. My name is Robert Sepper. I'm an anthropologist. My published work is available on Amazon, as well as through various other major book outlets. They make a great gift. If you'd like to support my work, you could do that through patreon.com. There should be a link in the description section for those that are interested. I appreciate it. Thank you. Please hit the like button and subscribe for future updates. As always, I look forward to reading your comments. So please leave me your thoughts below. Please have a wonderful weekend, and I hope to see you again soon.
In its place was a patchwork of petty states, whose rulers may have called themselves kings, but who in reality were little more than warlords who raided each other's territories for silver, slaves, and women. Sumuabam, though, seems to have wanted more. A legacy.
You know the bloke, who is it?
Oh, this is not it, actually. He's gone to the next video.
Over time, and with the improvement...
I've only got certain length here. Do you know, the movie Darkman?
No.
It's a good movie. It's a good movie.
Mm.
Anyway, it's like half cartoon, half... Like, it's all kind of cartoon, but they're very big stars that are in it. Anyway, the dude that wrote it, he wrote it back in the 70s.
Mm.
And they interviewed him in the early 90s. I can't remember his name at the moment, but he says, he stated that, which I found very interesting, that man has been around basically a million years.
Mm.
That's all.
Mm-hmm.
So we got here,
mm-hmm.
and for 500,000 years, all we knew was fire.
Mm-hmm.
And then somebody invented the wheel.
Mm-hmm.
So for 250,000 years, for another 250,000 years, we knew two things. So for 500,000 years, we knew one thing.
Mm.
250,000 years, we knew two things.
Mm-hmm.
And then we invented something else.
Mm.
So for 125,000 years, we knew weapons as well.
Mm.
They probably come before the wheel.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
And basically what he was saying, what he was saying exactly was every half period our information intake doubled.
Mm-hmm.
And at that rate, by the year 2015, this is what he's stating in the early 90s, by 2015, our intake of information will double every 15 minutes.
Mm. Yeah, we just and keep...
That was before the internet.
Mm. Yeah, oh yeah, we're taking in a lot of information.
Yeah.
And see, the thing... What are you after?
Lighter.
Oh, lighter. Might be over by the stove.
Oh, I'll get his name for you. Intelligent man.
Yeah, it's by the stove.
And he was... The establishment... snubbed him and
the
government hated him.
I see it like you may not have used TikTok before, but the way you it's actually a really quite a cool I think it's on the stove.
You're gone.
It's a I'll wait. It's all good. Clear my throat. Yeah, so TikTok is this... It seems that I use it quite a lot because there's a lot of really amazing content that people are making. It's like a free speech platform.
I haven't...
But
I like it. I've watched the shorts on YouTube.
Yeah.
I love them.
Yeah.
Love them.
Yes. Yeah, that's it. These short messages, they're just like, and you just flick through them.
Oh, they get you stuck.
But you just go boom, boom, boom. You're getting information.
They put me in a trance.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah. But if you do...
I can't suck enough in.
Yeah, that's it. But it's like you're fast-tracking information. If you're looking at the right topics, like if I look at like the spiritual talk stuff, there's lots of people talking about amazing stuff.
Can't do this and funny stuff.
Yeah, well, I haven't looked at comedy there. No, I'm just doing the spiritual stuff. But it's like I can get a lot of information.
You know what I did get stuck on was the
fast.
was the good, the what did they call it?
Just did you give him the lighter?
Yeah.
Yeah, just cheers.
The good people out there helping other people, caught on camera.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, like the old granny trying to cross the road, and he stops all the traffic on the highway and helps her out.
Yeah.
All the little ducklings trying to cross the road, and all the traffic stopped for the little ducks.
Yeah.
All that kind of stuff. You know?
Yeah.
But there's more than that, too. There's some good stuff there. There's a couple of people fighting, and they get out and stop.
I love it. Have you ever seen this on YouTube? It's called People Are Awesome.
That's it.
Have you? Oh, that's what you're talking about.
Oh,
yeah. It's fucking...
I absolutely love it.
Like, what's this?
I got hooked in it.
What's your favourite mountain range? Yeah, they're so fun, aren't they?
Oh, they're so good.
Where is it?
People. Did you see the dude that walks in and says to people, oh, can you pay for me groceries? Or pay for me thing?
Mm.
And the person that does, and he says, oh, here's $5,000.
Mm. Yeah.
He gives them $5,000.
Oh, man. Oh, that Mr. Beast.
I think so, yeah.
Yeah, he's fucking number one YouTuber.
Oh, is he?
Yeah. He is amazing because he basically... thank you. He basically gives everything he earns, but he keeps earning more. Right? It's this idea, you know, it's a universal law. Give and you shall receive.
That's right, yeah.
Right? Give and you shall receive 1,000 times.
Yeah, that's right, yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So that's what he does. He just like, he keeps giving.
The secret, isn't
the
it?
Secret, yeah, the yeah. Show. Yeah, the and secret. Like you look at his every video is like 20, 30 million views.
Yeah.
He's just nailing it. And it's the simplest shit.
It's what the world needs.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's exactly what they're looking for, and
exactly
they found it in him.
Yeah,
and he's done a fantastic job doing it. I loved it.
Yeah,
I loved it.
Yeah. Oh, look at this shit.
Yeah, I know. When I was younger,
yeah,
I
it is.
Not now.
Yeah. No, that's it. It's good deeds. This is that sign I want to put up. It's good thoughts, good words, and then good deeds.
Yeah.
You know, good deeds as in just helping.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's my... Yes, that's right.
Mm. Yeah, it's a good mantra to have, right? Hey?
Don't bogart out that joint.
Don't bogart. What does that mean?
It's in Cheech and Chong.
Sorry, I missed that bit.
Don't bogart that joint.
Is that like suck on it too much, or?
You know, I've got the.
Or just talk with it.
I've got the.
Is this talk with it?
The Cheech and Chong up in Smoke album.
Yeah.
The vinyl, I've got it.
Yeah, right.
It's in perfect condition.
Yeah, wow.
The cover and all.
Wow. Okay.
You know what I have got? I've got a special edition of Woman's Weekly of 1963 of the Queen and Prince Philip's visit to Australia just after they got married.
Yeah, right. Is that that'd be a collector's item?
Oh, it'd have to be, wouldn't
it? Yeah. Someone would just be like, wow, what that one.
it's like the whole thing is just on their visit, you know? Which, yeah.
And you just kept it?
Actually, it was my grandmother's and it was in a box.
Oh, wow, yeah.
Yeah. And the record I got, you know, in Victoria they do hard rubbish.
Mm.
And I found a box and it had hard rubbish, the record in it, and some other crappy new records in it.
Wow.
They just didn't want it anymore.
Yeah. That's the cool thing about antiques, you know. What are you going to find? There must be so much. I'm always fascinated with all the ancient artifacts.
Oh, I love and antiques.
Yeah.
Love them.
Yeah, totally.
I had a tall boy wardrobe.
Mm.
I loved it. It's like a gentleman's wardrobe, you know?
Yeah.
It's got a little section for the, you know, the shaving gear to put in. It's really, I loved it.
Hmm. Yeah, nice. So Bogart is this, right?
Is to keep the hog it.
Yeah. Oh, okay. I wouldn't be bogarting, would I?
Something to do with Humphrey Bogart.
Yeah.
I'm sure.
Yeah.
It was sad what happened to Chong, wasn't it? He basically was, you know, legally selling bongs and stuff on the internet.
That's right. Some and they got, they basically nailed him.
Some senators, some bought a bong.
They nailed him.
And the senator wanted him.
They nailed him.
And they got him.
They planned it and nailed him.
Old Cheech was the only one.
Because he was a he was one of those lights speaking
that's
out.
That's right. And
they made a huge impact. Like they were all over the world. I know as a kid they were. I was watching those videos.
On them, something shocking. But Cheech was the only one that visited him in jail.
Yeah, the whole time.
And when he got out, I remember when he got out and he went on David Letterman.
Yeah.
And he said, David Letterman actually said, do you mind if I talk about, you know, and he said, not at all. And he said, you know, Cheech was the only one that supported me. He was the only one that visited me. He said, I thought I had a lot of friends in Hollywood.
Mm.
He said, but nobody came and see me.
Yeah.
And then Cheech walked out onto the stage, you know.
Mm.
And they both cried. You know?
Mm.
Mm. Yeah, and it was amazing. It was so true. You know?
Trailblazers.
Oh, amazing.
Yeah. Yeah. You
know, what did he spend in there? 12 years or something?
Wow.
I'm not sure. Honestly, I'd have to.
The war on drugs.
Tap my memory.
The war on drugs is like we talked about, like police officers. Like I read. Before the war on drugs started, like in the 70s, policemen were like...
Early 80s, really.
Early 80s, okay. And so before then, policemen were part of the communities.
That's right.
They were part of the... They were integral parts.
Yep.
And they were accepted and they were seen as like helpful. But then when they started to bust people for fucking cannabis and... Like small little crimes, that changed, and then the police became,
and they put them on a point system,
right? Yeah, they just come down hard, and then suddenly police were different.
Yeah,
you know that's where they went wrong with that war on drugs. But you could say maybe it was intentional, just to cause fucking conflict.
Well, yeah, where they went wrong was definitely picking on marijuana users.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
They've lightened the laws over there now on that.
Oh, amazing.
It's emptying the jail.
We had one guy here say that he can get cannabis delivered within 2 hours anywhere in the States or obviously maybe California, you know.
Like but it is a sad fact, but, that, you know, America was the most populated jails in the world.
Mm, totally.
And yet... Most of it was marijuana users.
Right. Yep. So it's fucking crime against humanity.
Sad fact.
Crime against humanity.
You know, three strikes, and, you know, life jail. And the three strikes could have been, you know, just having an ounce of pot on you each time.
Yep.
And you're in with the murderer.
Yep. You know,
that's getting out 5 years.
Yep. Yeah, totally. It's it's a school for crime, right?
Oh, it's ridiculous.
Yeah. Yeah. Mm. You learn a lot in there.
I suspect so.
Yeah, I'm sure. I mean, that's like talking, because we are changing the world here, like the clan thing.
That's right.
You're putting all the criminals in a clan so they can, you can learn from everybody, you know?
Well,
from the masters as
I remember when I was younger and I might have, you know, not paid a fine or two and they put me in.
Right.
And I remember meeting a doctor in there, and he used to save up all his parking fines.
Hmm.
2-3 years. It'd be something like $8,000 worth of parking fines back then. Now that'd be worth probably about $25,000, maybe $30,000.
Hmm.
But they'd come around and they'd put him in jail for 3 days.
Yep.
And they'd all be paid.
Yep.
And a lot of his doctor friends were doing it.
Yep.
But then I met this lawyer, and he was in for 2 months because he got caught pissing in the gutter.
What?
And the coppers didn't like him.
Yeah, well, that's what I was going to say. There must have been a reason.
It's not much of a reason when, I believe that a lot of the Australian courts are just kangaroo courts anyway.
Yeah, I found that with the family court.
Come on. If it was a real system, you don't think that maybe every now and again a judge would have been pulled over drunk, you know, or, you know, caught doing some mischievous thing, you know, with women or other men? Of course they do. They're human beings. But I think that maybe the police keep that under their belt so that when they're in court with them,
they can
get what they want.
Well, that's exactly right. That's a world of blackmail, isn't it? Fucking world.
Funny story. I'm just thinking of. I read about this, the St Kilda, the King's Cross era back in the 80s, and the police, the King's Cross police, were the Sydney police were pretty bad. You know, they were Rogerson and all that. And I remember reading this story about this bloke getting harassed by the King's Cross police, and they took him into the station up on the third floor. And in the middle of the three buildings of the police station was a courtyard. And on the third floor, they used to hang the dudes out by their feet and say, we're going to drop you. And there was actually a couple of people that were hospitalised from falling out of it. Or let them drop down. And it was well known that they did it. So this guy was getting harassed, and I can't remember what it was over. I think it was over some kind of prostitution money or something, you know. And he wrote his name upside down. He had a texter in his pocket, and he wrote his name upside down. So he reneged on everything. So when it went to court, they said, "That's all right. We're gonna." You know, when it went to court, he told the judge. He said, "The judge, you know, they bashed me, they hit me, and they put me out the window, and they, you know, threatened to drop me." He said, "Son," he said, "unless you've got any proof," you know, he said, "Actually, I have, Your Honor." He said, "What proof's that?" He said, "Well, when they had me out the window hanging upside down, I wrote my name." And all the police in the court and all the reporters at the same time rushed to get out of the door. They were pushing each other to get out of the door. And the reporters got there first. Of course, this was time before mobile phones, so they had to get there, you know. And the reporters got there first, and so they couldn't cover it. They couldn't get rid of it. And so...
Is this a true story?
This is a true story. What? And then it went back to court, and he got not only got off the charges and that, but a couple of the coppers got charged.
Wow.
Yeah.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Fuck. Yeah.
I love it.
Yeah. It's, I think that in the same book... that hitchhiker killer was in there. What's his name? Ivan
Milat.
Yeah, that's it.
Yeah.
His story's in that same book.
Yeah, so. Yeah.
Oh, look, there's some great Australian books out there.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Yeah,
the system's, I don't know. It's pretty bad.
Yeah, it really is.
It really is. I'd like to think that we've got an upcoming group of solicitors, barristers in the schools now, with a bit more free thinking and fairness in mind instead of money. I think that, what do they call it? When you have less and less, you live with less and less. They're doing a lot of that now, I can't remember. Minimalization, is that right?
That would work, yeah. Minimalizing their lives.
Yeah, that's there's a documentary on Netflix called Minimalizer.
Yeah, okay.
And, there's a lot of that happening with a lot of, you know, kind of rich young
people. Sure, yeah. I think there's a lot of good happening.
I think there is.
It's, and it's coming up all through the system.
All the Chinese kids and that, they're starting to refuse to work.
Yeah, totally. You know,
they think it's a slave system.
Yeah. We've got in China, you mean?
They just opened the borders today.
So,
as I know.
We have a young Chinese girl here who's an architect. And she was on her final assignment, and she decided she didn't want to hand it in.
She's got a hand.
Because because she said she didn't want to become an architect. Yeah.
Why?
It's a sort of a protest, I think, at the whole architectural industry.
Wow.
Yeah, and so I started talking to her about the dreams for this place.
Yeah.
And it's like, we need, you know, we want to build all these beautiful buildings. And so, yeah, she's like, so she can be like a real architect, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So she's come and planted herself.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So that's really exciting.
She's a beautiful person, too.
She really is, yeah.
She really is.
Yep. Yeah, so that's the cool thing is, you know, you get in lawyers and you're getting architects and you're getting engineers that are starting to wake up.
You are.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, and those guys are the pretty powerful because they've been trained in the world of you know, how to think logically, make things happen.
Yeah, definitely. We spoke about the hunted monkey effect.
Yeah,
I think that the world's getting in such a panic about the state of affairs of the planet that the subconscious is just exploding with that fear and.
Mm.
And it's either greed or
or love.
Yeah,
right?
That's right.
Yeah, yeah, I feel that too. It's like this crossroads, and you get to choose which way you want to go.
And everybody's sick and tired of the greed. Of the greed is good.
Sure.
You know,
man. That's why people are seeing it. So,
who said that? Michael Douglas in a movie back in the late 80s, I think, or 90s. Greed is good.
Mm, that's right. Yeah.
You know.
Yep. Yep.
And it worked.
Mm. For a little bit.
It did.
Mm. Yeah, but yes.
Well, did it get greedy?
Mm. Yeah, really. Mm. So that's why, bringing me back to building tribes.
Yes.
Right.
Absolutely.
It's like we have to rebuild our society again. You know, we have to build it in the right way. And so you've got to come back to that first state that was more natural, which is the original, which was the tribe system.
Yes.
You know this, because there's an other force happening, that which is, rather than bringing us together, it's separating us. And I realize this in, because there's this big Saudi development, this $1 billion development. It's going to be 100 kilometers long.
That's right.
Like a housing development.
That's right. No, a city development.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. But it's a line.
Yeah.
And it's like
complete city.
Yeah.
With residential.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah.
Markets.
Yeah, yeah. Business. Yeah, but it's only like maybe 200 meters wide.
That's right. It's not. It might be a little bit. Yeah, it could be about that. Yeah, 200 meters.
So it's got an airport. So it's got everything. And it's got transport up and down, you know, flat out. The thing is like, to build the correct city or anything, like it has to be a circle. Like a line.
Isn't that interesting?
Totally separates us. Totally isolates us into fucking boxes.
Yeah, it does, because, like, when you walk in the supermarket, they make sure they put the milk at the back corner so you walk past everything else.
Yeah, down the lines.
Yeah, it's a class. It's a class separation.
Because
they're going to have the servants and all the workers and that down one end. And,
probably would. They would. You're right.
Not, it's not going to all be mixed in.
Yeah, probably not.
And all the rich are going to be on the other end. And
they'll have the fan. Yeah, I didn't even think about that. Yeah, that's another thing. It'll be classed.
But it'll be easy to control that way.
Sure, totally. So that is the thing. A line is easy to control.
Yeah.
Right. So this is this idea that, like, these circles of villages, you know, you build the town in a circle.
That's
so
you've
got the town center.
Yeah.
Is where everyone comes together.
Yeah.
You know, like, but. You
they
look
used
at
to do that. They used to
I know.
Even before the Second World War, they used to have the big old tree in the middle of the village.
Right.
And if any of the teenagers had issues or anything, they would all come together as a family, the town, and raise that child.
Mm.
You know, it's that is a tribal thing.
Mm. Yeah.
And yeah, of course, they bombed out all the villages. That was part of the plan.
Ah.
Get rid of all the villages because there was thousands of them.
Wow.
There wasn't many cities.
Wow.
And since the Second World War, look how many cities have been built.
Yeah.
You know, and they've congregated us all in these cities. It's interesting how you say it.
That's fascinating.
I love how you've brought up how it's a line. I like you're stuck on that. I can say that Einstein believed that there were many dimensions. Now, if you take the first dimension, it's just a straight line. There's no up, down, sideways.
Exactly.
Now, if you take the second dimension, you can see the first dimension, but the first dimension cannot see you. If you take the third dimension, the second dimension cannot see the third, but the third can see the second. And we live in a three-dimensional world. And Einstein says that the fourth dimension, and which all scientists, Carl Sagan said the same thing, the fourth dimension cannot be drawn on paper. It cannot be made into a scale or a model. It's something that you can only have in your mind, you know, and it's hard to describe.
Totally.
But if that's a fact about the other dimensions, that means the fourth dimension can see us and we can't see it. So that's what that line is. It's a stage of dimensions.
Yeah, and it limits you to that one dimension.
Yeah, and you cannot see except in these lines. They make sure that only a select few can see down, back down to the start, you know, all the workers. And they're usually the decision makers, the lawmakers.
Yeah.
The money that the people that don't need the money.
Totally. So, like, it's a complete... If they... This is like a fucking... Whoever come up with this idea... Like, what the fuck? They're not trying to build fucking communities.
It's dark.
It's dark. It is. They're not trying to build communities at all. They're trying to separate us further. And I realize that in suburbs. You know, it's the same thing. Why are they not in, like, circles or what? They're all lines, you know, keeping us in our lines. We only get to know the neighbours left and right.
Yeah, yeah. And to me, to put that, to come here and learn that we need an energy out there to further this movement because they do a good job of housing us and trapping us. And then we get to realise... through this information explosion that we're trapped and there's nothing, it's too late, we can't do anything. And coming here and learning that that's part of the energy that is released from this farm out to the world when it goes back out with these, with the people that come here.
Exactly.
You know, and so they will overcome, they will, and I believe that that energy is to just keep trying and keep and just if that little bit disagree that little bit just that little bit disagree you know,
totally,
don't
take totally
it, don't, you know,
it just opens the possibilities a little bit.
There's no reason to argue the point, but my goodness, there's no reason not to ask a question. You know,
and I had this the thought, you know, that they say that the butterfly flaps its wings.
That's right.
And on the other side of the earth, a hurricane will appears. Happen. Yeah, yeah. So you don't know who you're influencing.
That's right.
It could be that, you know, hurricane.
Yeah. and you, it's got to be planted into the subconscious. You know, so to be thinking that way and you know, is a good way of planting it. You know.
And that's by doing it and. That's why I'm really keen now to get this 12 tribe example happening.
Absolutely.
Yeah. And then obviously aiming to get a whole demonstration project happening, like on a big scale.
Yeah.
5,000 people.
Yeah.
All, and it's all around healing modalities, but plus, you know, entertainment. And but you still got to be fully self-sufficient. So you got to have other industries that you know, you got to have the solar panels, you got to have the wind turbines, you got to have all that infrastructure. People have got to manage all that as well.
I like the idea of the tree planting.
Tree planting.
I love it.
Yeah.
As you know, when I was living in Taylor's Arms, New South Wales, as I said, this guy, he planted, I think it was about 100 paulownia trees, and he really urged me to do the same thing. He said 10 years, they'll be worth 10 grand, Shane. And they were. They were. And it was only, 10 years is not a long time in that kind of thing.
No, it's not. You're right. It happens quick.
Yeah, it does. And, and they grew beautifully. And, you know, I always thought, you know, you go up north a bit, get some of that beautiful red dirt, bring it back there, mix it with this dirt down here. Beautiful, you know.
Wow. That's a cool dream.
You know.
Yeah.
I mean, then trees like that would absolutely blossom down in an area like this, you know. This is very similar to Taylor's Arms weather. Very similar.
Yeah, okay.
So, yeah. And they're beautiful trees.
Yeah, what sort of tree? Oh, the paulownia.
Yeah, some people call them cherry trees.
Yeah, I swear there's a guy growing them on the way to Augusta.
Oh,
Yeah, wow. Yeah, that's the thing. You can have the agroforestry clan.
Yeah.
You know, they're just in planting.
Is that what that dude was talking about the other day? To seek information about that.
What's that?
From some council or something about tree planting.
Oh, there's a group called Activate.
Oh, okay.
And they plant trees. They have festivals.
I've heard of them.
Yeah.
They'd be.
They've got three or four festivals a year.
Yeah.
And it's out in the wheat belt, and they go to a farm and set it all up with entertainment and do all the food, and you buy tickets. And they sell out every year, and then you go and plant trees for 3 days during it. So you're planting 15,000 trees with a group of 100 people.
Wow.
It's really fun. Everyone gets together and So
you'd have to put down ribbon markers or something.
Oh,
for
the
people to plant.
So they've got the. It's like a dredger.
Okay.
It just makes the channels.
Okay.
So it pretty much gives it a line.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. So we just follow the lines along. Okay.
Oh, that'd be beautiful.
Yeah. Yeah. And you see this farm that they've been working on for 10 years.
Yeah.
Because they just cleared the shit out of the wheat belt, right? Took all the trees down.
That's right. Same as they did in South Australia.
Yeah. Just they really bulldozed them. And so there's a lot of space that needs trees.
Yeah.
It's insane how many trees you need to plant.
They've torn down a few big ones.
Yeah. Yeah, we had the neighbour here, Colin, he was working for clearing land.
Okay.
And he was saying the West Australian government had a quota of how many acres to clear per year. I think up into the 80s.
Yeah, yeah.
And so it was just clear that land, you've got to meet the quota.
Jeez.
And he
would have been a lot too.
Millions of hectares so that's wow. That's a movement where the green movement, you
imagine
know.
Imagine what they made extinct.
Sure.
You don't even know.
Sure. Yeah. Just the weather patterns changed because all that tree loss.
That's right.
Yeah, the lows don't come as high as they used to.
Yeah.
And they think that the winds are stronger because there's less trees, and that means the lows, don't come as high as they used to. See, there's less rain.
So I wouldn't have a clue.
Anyway, tired. Taking the trees away is change the weather patterns here.
Okay. Wow, that's a lot of trees, dude.
Yeah. Anyway, so it's one of my favorite things to do actually is plant trees and watch them grow.
Oh, love it.
Yeah, it's like your children growing.
I'll be honest with you, sometimes I shake them.
Yeah,
I love it.
Yeah, I haven't tried that, but
yeah, Yeah, it's quite fun.
Mm.
You can make little canopy trees and stuff. And, you know, so you can put benches underneath them.
Totally, yep. Around the base. Yep.
You just shape them. So the branches are all kind of weird shapes, you know.
Mm.
Just let them put like a bands around the branches while they grow and things like that. And let them, and they turn out pretty interesting sometimes. I like to do it in the house gardens, you know.
Yeah, awesome. Yeah. That's the thing. There's so much creation you can do, right?
I used to make cactus gardens. And,
yeah, right.
You know, things like that.
Sweet. Yeah. Well, I'm doing a cactus garden out here.
Loved it.
Yeah. Getting it like circles.
Oh, yeah.
Cool. And have, so each circle, different size, and they have cactus and, you know, sacred plants grown in there.
Cool.
Bit of tobacco, some cannabis.
Cool.
And then what you do is when we have groups in our circles, then you can sit around them and like have little meetings.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That'd be nice.
Yeah. To sit around these sacred plants.
Yeah.
And talk. I reckon that'd be cool as fuck.
Yeah, it's good Mars doing this garden out here.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, yeah. That
I helped her with some aloe vera the other day, and that's great that she's going to be splitting that up and putting that in.
And
let it thrive. And
Yeah, and we want to put plants all through this barn.
I think it's important to have an aloe vera section.
Yeah, yeah.
Because once it does thrive, it will be very important for maybe if you know, kids have accidents. At least make sure the wound is going to be okay.
Yeah, we've got to have a whole herb garden.
You know?
Have every herb.
Yeah,
that's everything. Just have every plant.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Garlic, ginger.
Yeah, everything. Even like all the herbs from the past.
Yeah.
I want to have a sacred garden here. Mint. Yeah. Yeah. Well. Catnip. I don't know.
With the lamb.
Yeah, I want to have this sacred garden, which becomes eventually like a tour, a place where people come on tour.
Yeah.
And you just have all the sacred plants, like, cause most people have never seen tobacco, right?
Yeah, it's down the road. No, where is it?
Well, I've got one just here.
Yeah. Yeah, it's back
here. Yeah.
Queensland.
But most people haven't seen them. Never seen the flowers. Like, no, most people don't even know what a cannabis plant looks like.
Yeah, it's true.
Yeah, and it's like, well, we're going to educate people.
Yeah.
So we're creating a botanical garden.
People keep saying it's purple haze.
Right.
I don't know why.
But why not be able to grow different cannabis strains as well there as in the garden, right? Because they're all, purple. It looks purple. Yeah. So yeah, you know what I mean?
Right. It's like there's a lot of strains. Could you,
and they all grow differently. They all look different. We should be able to, like I want to create that space where it's a tour and to see all these different varieties. And
might be able to get your permit to grow the paper mull.
That would be good as well. Yeah, hemp. We want to grow hemp.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
The paper one.
Yeah, yeah.
You know how easy it is to make paper out of that stuff?
Yeah.
You have to soak it overnight.
Yeah, yeah.
Water.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, it's an amazing substance. We should all grow it. We should be allowed to grow it. Yeah.
Still in America.
Imagine what you can.
To China, make rope.
Mm.
Yeah. There's rope in the world because it's made of hemp.
Yep.
And then in 23, 27 or something. DuPont created a chemical that could break down ancient trees. It still took them a week or 2 weeks to break it down. But they were national forests, so they can get the wood for free. This is how DuPont made their money.
Right.
And they made it marijuana illegal.
Mm.
So they had to stop using marijuana
to make
beautiful quality paper.
It was a win-win. Huge
paper industry.
Yeah, but what I mean win-win, it was like they won with the paper, and then they won with the shutting down, making marijuana illegal, right? Which because I believe cannabis helps with people's expansion of their minds.
Absolutely.
Like it's Shiva. Shiva was a Hindu god, the first one, the Adi Yogi, and he's always shown with cannabis.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's used as a, you know, it helps us expand, and I guarantee every cannabis smoker you've ever met is interesting as fuck.
Yeah.
Right.
Mexicans, they use it. They've got a great medical history with it.
Yeah, yeah, it's a very powerful plant.
You know, and in clothing.
Yeah, everything. You know, they found some 6 foot six redhead people or Europeans in northern China like 3,000 years ago.
Oh, yeah, they found them like recently, didn't they?
Yeah, yeah. And that, but they had bags of cannabis with them.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Cool.
Yeah.
They probably went and scored off the Chinese and got lost on the way home.
That, maybe. That's what happened. Smoked too much, got lost. Fell in the cave. Yeah, but that's pretty interesting. And then you go even deeper and it's like there's actually pyramids in China that they've like...
Yeah, I know, but it's still got the cap on it. And they say that there's a giant crystal above it.
Mm, right.
And they've been trying to get photos. The American government have been trying. They sent U2s over in the late 60s. This is how long they've been trying to get photos and get information. And they're saying incredible things about this. I mean,
yeah, right.
They reckon the energy that comes from it could power... like the planet, it's very, very big, this thing.
Yeah, right.
I read about this about 12 months ago, I think.
Yep.
And it really intrigued me.
So it's like an old pyramid that they've put the crystal.
It's ancient. Yeah. But it's huge.
Yep.
They're saying it could be bigger than the Giza.
Yeah, right.
So,
yeah. So this is like, when did that civilization happen, you know? It's like, could it be 5,000 years ago, or is it like before the last ice age? You know, we don't know.
I don't know.
No. But the only things that survive are pyramids.
if all the other pyramids have been proven that they point at Sirius at their times of build. And this pyramid has to be part of those pyramids, it has to be a part of that chain.
And if they're all linked together,
and if you're saying that there was red-headed giants found in China, I truly believe that, you know, the Atlanteans, their land was taken from them by nature, and they drifted off in all directions and to teach the world and warn the world. And they come to teach the lazy cavemen, the lazy Neanderthals, as we were. That has to be a part of that. But what intrigues me is this crystal. Because they're really saying that Giza, they're starting to say that Giza was some kind of power station, the wireless power station. They reckon that the pyramids were laid in leaf gold or something. Has all been taken and stolen.
Yep. I read somewhere that the Giza was in like this limestone.
Yes.
Like white limestone.
Yeah.
That shone like a mirror.
Yep, and it was capped with gold.
Yeah.
And it had a crystal on top.
Probably. Yeah. Well, because none of them have got the fucking crystal. They've all been, you know. Yeah. Hidden.
Yeah.
Hidden from history.
Oh, yeah. Oh, Rothschild's got something.
Oh, yeah. The
Rockefellers, you can see them there, tug of war and with one of them.
You know, you want to hear a conspiracy that I think is true,
yeah.
And I've never heard anyone talk about it.
I'd love to.
You know Tutankhamun?
Oh, I don't know personally, but
yeah. So, like, like some of the most gold and like the most precious stuff recovered in any tomb.
That's
like,
right.